Hi guys, in this video we'll be looking into the chapter of nationalism. So in this chapter we'll be looking into the concepts of nation and nationalism, acknowledge the strengths and limitations of nationalism, appreciate the need for ensuring the link between democracy and nationalism. So introducing nationalism, if we were to take a quick poll of what people commonly understand of the term nationalism, we are likely to get responses that talk about patriotism, national flags, sacrificing for the country, and the like. Okay, the Republic Day parade in Delhi is a striking symbol of Indian nationalism and brings about the sense of power, strength, as well as diversity, which many associate with the Indian nation. But if we try to go deeper, we will find that it is difficult to arrive at a precise and widely accepted definition of the term nationalism. This need not mean that we should abandon the effort. Nationalism needs to be studied because it plays such an important role in world affairs. Okay, chaliye dekhte hain kya hai. Okay, during last two centuries or more, nationalism has emerged as one of the most compelling political creeds, which has helped to shape history. Okay, we have seen in lectures about European nationalism, the rise of European nationalism, the nation states, all these aspects we have looked into. It has inspired intense loyalties as well as deep hatreds. It has united people as well as divided them, helped to liberate them from oppressive rule, as well as been the cause of conflict and bitterness and wars. It has been a factor in the breakup of empires and states. Nationalist struggles have contributed to the drawing and redrawing of boundaries of the states and empires. Okay, now we come to some historical phases of nationalism. Nationalism has passed through many phases. For instance, in the 19th century Europe, it led to the unification of a number of small kingdoms into larger nation states. The present-day German and Italian states were formed through such a process of unification and consolidation. A large number of new states were also founded in Latin America. Along with the consolidation of state boundaries, local dialects and local loyalties were also gradually consolidated into state loyalties and common languages. The people of the new states acquired a new political identity, which was based on a membership of the nation state. We have seen a similar process of consolidation taking place in our own country in the last century or more. But nationalism has also caused the breaking away of nations, such as the Austro-Hungarian nation, or we can see in the recent times the breakup of the British, the French and Portuguese empires in Africa and Asia. And also we can see the struggle for freedom from the colonial rule by India and other colonies that were also national struggles inspired by desire to establish nation states which would be independent of foreign control. The process of redrawing state boundaries continued to take place. There are still such separatist movements developing among Quebec in Canada, Basque in North Spain, Kurds in Turkey and Iraq, the Tamils in Sri Lanka are some of the examples. And also Arab nationalism today may hope to unite Arab countries in a pan-Arabic union, but separatist movements like the Kurds struggle to divide existing states. Okay, so nations and nationalism. A nation is not any casual collection of people. At the same time, it is also different from other groups or communities found in human society. It is different from the family, which is based on face-to-face relationship with each member having direct personal knowledge of the identity and character of others. It is not similar to the family in which we know each other. And also it is also different from tribes and clans and other kinship groups in which ties of marriage and descent link members to each other. Okay, in tribal areas or in tribal communities, we marry people from the own tribe. Okay, that kind of situation is not there, or people belong to a same family tree. That kind of situation is not there in a nation. Okay, and also, but as a member of a nation, we may never come face to face with most of our fellow nationals, nor need we share ties of descent with them. Okay, our forefathers will be different, and also another citizen of a nation, his forefathers will also be different. Okay, yet nations exist, are lived in and valued by their members. It is commonly believed that nations are constituted by a group who share certain features such as descent, language, or religion, or ethnicity. But there is in fact no common set of characteristics which is present in all nations. Many nations do not have a common language. Canada, for example, Canada includes English speaking as well as French speaking people. India also has a large number of languages which are spoken in different regions. Okay, India is a very diverse country. What then constitute a nation? A nation is to a large extent an imagined community held together by a collective beliefs, aspirations, and imaginations of its members. It is based on certain assumptions which people make about collective whole with which they identify. Okay, now let us identify some of the assumptions which people make about nation. So shared beliefs is the first one. First, nation is constituted by belief. Nation are not like mountains, rivers, or buildings which we can see and feel. They are not things which exist independent of the beliefs people have about them. To speak of a people as a nation is not to make a comment about their physical characteristics or behavior. Rather, it is to refer to the collective identity and vision for the future of a group which aspires to have an independent political existence. To this extent, nations can be compared with a team. In our country, for example, all the Indians want a common thing. There is a common belief. We believe in the constitution of the country. We believe that Indians as a whole, they can stand together. We believe that we don't need support from external countries in the matter of our administration. Okay, that kind of belief is there between the Indian community or Indian nationals. When we speak of a team, we mean a set of people. When we speak of a team, we mean a set of people who work or play together, or more importantly, conceive of themselves as a collective group. If they do not think of themselves in this way, they would cease to be a team. There will not be a team and be simply different individuals playing a game or undertaking a task. A nation exists when its members believe that they belong together. So after belief, now we should have a history. Second, people who see themselves as a nation also embody a sense of continuing historical identity. That is, nations perceive themselves as stretching back into the past as well as reaching into the future. They articulate for themselves a sense of their own history by drawing a collective memories, legends, historical records to outline the continuing identity of the nation. Okay, whenever we discuss our national history, we look into our struggle against the British colonizers, we look into the struggles about the Rajput kingdoms, about the, we have an aspiration, we look into the glorious years of the Mughal Empire. All these aspects are there, part of our history, a collective history. Thus, nationalists in India invoke its ancient civilization and cultural heritage and other achievements to claim that India has had a long and continuing history as a civilization, and that this civilizational continuity and unity is the basis of the Indian nation. And Jawaharlal Nehru, for instance, wrote in his book, Discovery of India. This can be used as a quote in Main's answers. Though outwardly there was diversity and infinite variety among people, everywhere there was that tremendous impress of oneness which held all of us together. In ages past, whatever political fate or misfortune had befallen us, even though the British came to India, they divided us. They tried to divide us based on our religion, based on our caste. Okay, all these things happened. Even though all these things happened, yet we had a collective identity. When Gandhi came and professed when he prophesized about a nation, that is India, we all together followed him for a collective cause. Okay. as Indians. Territory, that is the third point. Third, nations identify with a particular territory, sharing a common past and living together on a particular territory over a long period of time gives people a sense of their collective identity. It helps them to imagine themselves as one people. It is therefore not surprising that people who see themselves as nations speaks of a homeland, the territory they occupied, and the land on which they have lived has a special significance for them, and they claim it as their own. Nations, however, characterize the homeland and in different ways. Homeland in different ways. For instance, suppose they call it as a motherland, okay, or fatherland, or holy land. The Jewish people, for instance, they are spread throughout the world, but they had a concept about homeland as Palestine, the promised land. The Indian nation identifies the rivers, mountains, and regions of the Indian subcontinent. However, since more than one set of people may lay claim to the same territory, the aspiration of a homeland has been a major cause of conflict in the world. Okay, suppose, for example, of the Kurd region. Kurd region comes in between the Turkish region and the Iraq and the Iran also. So, three countries are there. In between, we have the Kurd. So, Kurd, they declared themselves as an autonomous region. But still, they have a shared territory. Okay, that is an example. So, shared political ideals. So, fourth point is, while territory and shared historical identity play an important role in creating a sense of oneness, it is a shared vision of the future and the collective aspiration to have an independent political existence that distinguishes groups from nations. Members of a nation share a vision of the kind of state they want to build. They affirm, among other things, a set of values and principles such as democracy, secularism, and liberalism. These ideals represent the terms under which they come together and are willing to live together. It represents, in other words, their political identity as a nation. For example, in our country, we have the preamble. It represents the political will of our country. For example, we are a democratic socialist republic. Okay, that emphasizes what kind of ideals we support. Okay, in a democracy, it is shared commitment to a set of political values and ideals that is the most desirable basis of a political community or a nation state. Within it, members of the political community are bound by a set of obligations. These obligations arise from the recognition of the rights of each other as citizens. A nation is strengthened when people acknowledge and accept their obligations to their fellow members. We might even say that recognition of this framework of obligations is the strongest test of loyalty to the nation. Now, another thing, that is common political identity. What is it? Many people believe that a shared political vision about the state and society we wish to create is not enough to bind individuals together as a nation. Although we have a history, a territory, or a political identity, that is not enough. They seek instead a shared cultural identity, such as a common language or common descent. There is no doubt that speaking the same language makes it easier for us to communicate with each other, and sharing the same religion gives us a set of common beliefs and social practices. Observing the same festivals, seeking the same holidays, holding the same symbols, valuable can bring people together. But it can also pose a threat to the values in which we cherish in a democracy. There are two reasons for this. Why is it a threat? Okay, one, all major religions in the world are internally diverse. They have survived and evolved through a dialogue within the community. As a result, there exist within each religion a number of sects or divisions who differ significantly in their interpretation of the religious text and norms. If we ignore these differences and forge an identity on the basis of common religion, we are likely to create a highly authoritative and oppressive society. Okay, that is the first part. We need to respect all these aspects or the divisions in the religious communities. So, one practice can lead to a conflict with other sect in the same religion. Okay, so that kind of habit should be removed. Two, most societies are culturally diverse. They have people belonging to different religions and languages living together in the same territory. To impose a single religious or linguistic identity as a condition of belonging to a particular state would necessarily exclude some groups. Example, we can see it in Sri Lanka. When Sinhala language was adopted, that created tensions between the Sinhalese community and the Tamil community. It might restrict the religious liberty of this excluded group or disadvantage those who do not speak the national language. Either way, the ideal we cherish most in democracy, namely equal treatment and liberty for all, would be severely limited. For both these reasons, it is desirable to imagine the nation in political rather than cultural terms. That is, democracies need to emphasize and expect loyalty to a set of values that may be enshrined in the constitution. So, first and foremost, importance should be given to the constitution. What the constitution lays down. What are the principles in the constitution? That should be taken as the Bible of the country. Okay. We have identified some of the ways in which nations express their sense of collective identity. We have seen why democratic states need to forge this identity on the basis of shared political ideals. We have seen it. Okay. Rather than cultural ideals, we saw why is it important to have a political identity. Okay. But we are still left with an important question. Namely, why do people imagine themselves as a nation? What are some of the aspirations of different nations? Okay. So, next two questions will be addressing this question. First one is national self-determination. Nations, unlike other social groups, seek the right to govern themselves and determine their future development. They seek, in other words, the right to self-determination. In making this claim, a nation seeks recognition and acceptance by the international community of its status as a distinct political entity or state. Most often, these claims come from people who have lived together on a given land for a long period of time and who have a sense of common identity. In some cases, such claims of self-determination are linked also to the desire to form a state in which the culture of the group is protected, if not privileged. So, claims of this can be frequently made in the 19th century in Europe. Okay, this is the historical background. Okay, the notion of one culture, one state began to gain acceptability at that time. Subsequently, the idea of one culture, one state was employed while reordering the state boundaries after World War I. The Treaty of Versailles established a number of small, newly independent states, but it proved virtually impossible to satisfy all the demands of the self-determination which were made at that time. Besides, reorganization of state boundaries to satisfy the demands of one culture, one state, led to mass migration of population across state boundaries. Millions of people, as a consequence, were displaced from their homes and expelled from land which that was their home. Okay, and many others were victims of communal violence. This same scenario happened in India too during the time of partition. Okay, so I have made a video about the partition in the past. So look into it. It is really good. It is based on NCERT text only. Humanity paid a heavy price for reorganizing boundaries in a way that culturally distinct communities could form separate nation state. Besides, even this effort, it was not possible to ensure that the newly created contained only one ethnic community. Indeed, most states had more than one ethnic and cultural community living within its boundaries. Hence, the problem of accommodating minorities as equal citizens remained. The only positive aspect of these developments as it is at its guaranteed political recognition of various groups who saw themselves as distinct nations and wanted opportunity to govern themselves and determine their own future. So, political identity is an essential characteristics rather than the cultural identity. So, virtually every state in the world today faces the dilemma or confusion of how to deal with movements of self-determination. And this has raised questions about the right to national self-determination. More and more people are beginning to realize that the solution does not lie in creating new states, but in making existing states more democratic and equal. That is, in ensuring that people with different cultural and ethnic identities live and coexist as partners and equal citizens within the country. This may be essential not only for resolving problems arising from new claims of self-determination, but also for building a strong and united state. After all, a nation state which do not respect the rights and cultural identity of minorities within the state would find it difficult to gain the loyalty of its members. So the next aspect is the nationalism and pluralism. Okay, once we abandon the idea of one culture, one state, it becomes necessary to consider ways in which different cultures and communities can survive and flourish within a country. It is in pursuit of this goal that many democratic societies today have introduced measures for recognizing and protecting the identity of cultural minority communities living within their territory. The Indian Constitution has an elaborate set of provisions for the protection of religious, linguistic, and cultural minorities. The kinds of group rights which have been guaranteed in different countries include constitutional protection of the language, cultures, and religion of minority groups and their members. In some cases, identified communities also have the right to representation as a group in linguistic legislative bodies and other state institutions. In the case of Lebanon, Lebanon is divided based on religion, in which the president is from the Maronite Catholic community, and also the prime minister is from a Shia Muslim community. That is how the government of Lebanon works. The key positions are given to the key religious communities in Lebanon. Okay. In some cases, identified communities also have the right to representation as a group in legislative bodies and other state institutions. Such rights may be justified on the grounds that they provide equal treatment and protection of the law for members of these groups, as well as protection of the cultural identity of the group. Different groups need to be granted recognition as a part of the national community. This means that the national identity has to be defined in an inclusive manner, which can recognize the importance and unique contribution of all the cultural communities within the state. All cultural communities, all different minorities or majorities, all their cultures should be recognized. Okay, to sum up, the right to national self-determination was often understood to include the right to independent statehood for nationalities. But not only would it be impossible to grant independent statehood to every group that it sees itself as a distinct cultural group or nation, it would probably also be undesirable. It might lead to formation of a number of states too small to be economically and politically viable, and it would multiply the problems of minorities. The right has now been reinterpreted to mean granting certain democratic rights for a nationality within a state. Okay, the world we live in is one that is deeply conscious of the importance of giving recognition to identities. Today we witness many struggles for the recognition of group identities, many of which employ language of nationalism. While we need to acknowledge the claims of identity, we should be careful not to allow identity claims to lead to divisions and violence in the society. Suppose you are from a particular community, I am from another community. That does not mean our viewpoints should clash. That will in turn lead to violence. Okay, that is not what we need. Okay, we need to remember that each person has many identities. For instance, a person may have identities based on gender, caste, religion, language, or region. May be proud of all of them. So long as each person feels that he or she can freely express the different dimensions of his or her personality, they may not feel the need to make claims on the state for political recognition and concessions for any one identity. In a democracy, the political identity of a citizen should encompass the different identities which people may have. It would be dangerous if intolerant and homogenizing forms of identity and nationalism are allowed to develop. So that is it for in the chapter of nationalism. I hope you guys were able to follow today's lecture, and I hope it was productive for you guys. So until next time, we meet again. God bless you all. Jai Hind.